Sure, anytime you like, sir.
Okay. Good afternoon. Thanks for coming. It's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Paul Ingmundson. He is an adjunct professor in neurology at the Health Science Center, and he's our chief of sleep medicine here at the VA hospital. He's also the clinical director in the Alamo Sleep Center and the Mind Science Foundation Chief Science Officer. And he's going to teach us about sleep disorders medicine, an update on sleep diagnostics and therapeutics for the geriatrician. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Ingmundson. Could we, I don't know if you can see that.
Please.
Yeah, where
thanks.
It's dangerous to turn down the lights because you all will be sleepy, but I guess that's the risk we'll take. Okay. It's very dangerous to hand a PowerPoint presentation to a professor because you just end up running through a lot of slides very quickly. But I will, if you do have questions as we go along, please interrupt because I think that would probably improve the level of arousal and discourse as well. So don't hesitate to interrupt me as I go along here. I do have a lot of material, but if we don't get through it all, that's not going to be terrible. Okay, so you're busy. You know, you have to, I mean, you jam your seminars and education into your lunch period. Why should you bother asking your patients about sleep? Well, I think one reason that should motivate you is that over 50% of adults have at least one sleep problem. So if you walk into clinic, flip a coin, and if it comes up heads, that patient probably has a sleep problem. The prevalence of the most commonly referred laboratory-based sleep investigation is obstructive sleep apnea. 10 to 20% of adults over 55 have sleep apnea in a primary care setting. There's an increased prevalence of restless legs and insomnia in older patients. For these reasons, I think of sleep as the dark matter in the healthcare universe. Patients come in with a lot of complaints such as fatigue, difficulty with concentration, mood disturbances, and so forth. If you probe a little beyond that, oftentimes you'll find a sleep disorder underlying these complaints. So that's why it's useful to inquire about sleep. Sleep disorders, as I say, are common. Sleep disorders are underdiagnosed. And one of the most interesting and important things, I think, is that sleep disorders are treatable. This is very interesting, especially within the domain of neurology. Neurology is very good at describing many conditions that we have very little to do in terms of treating, if we are thinking about neurodegenerative disorders. But sleep disorders, in contrast, are very treatable, and they respond fairly quickly to treatment. So this is, again, I think, a motivating factor that should get a clinician interested in asking about sleep problems. This is an overview of what we're going to try to cover today. I'm going to say something briefly about sleep mechanisms, some basic mechanisms that are involved in the control of sleep. I'm going to go over some common sleep disorders that commonly present to the geriatric clinician, and then I'm going to close with a patient with a polymorbid sleep problem that I think is all too common in the kind of patients that you encounter in your daily work. Okay, sleep mechanisms, sleep stages, circadian rhythms. Just to start with, we live in a sleepless society. We actually sleep about an hour, hour and a half less than our grandparents did. The average American today gets less than 7 hours of sleep. Our grandparents got 8.5 to 9 hours of sleep. So we have a sleep-deprived culture, and we've come up with all these adaptations to try to deal with it. So you're never more than 500 yards away from a caffeine distribution point in this city, where you can get an infusion of caffeine to counteract your chronic sleep deprivation. We are basically infused with caffeine in order to maintain alertness to counteract the effects of our chronic sleep deprivation. This has become a cultural norm, and it's one of the most underappreciated shifts in our biology over the past 50 years. We all know that we reproduce less and we've grown fatter, but we also sleep less, and this is a very important effect on the way culture has affected our biology. When we think about what controls sleep, I think it's helpful to think about three basic mechanisms that are involved. And I've outlined them here in terms of these three mechanisms. First of all, we have homeostasis, and this is probably the aspect of sleep that you're most familiar with. That sleep is a function, sleep drive is a function of prior wakefulness. The longer you are awake, the sleepier you get. And if it were that simple, then we could just boil everything down in terms of that one principle. Sleep is a homeostatic process. But in addition to that, there's some other very important factors that have to be considered. And anybody that's been through medical training is aware of this in the first year of medical school, because what happens the first time you have to stay up all night? You stay up all night, right? And you feel like 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock in the morning, you feel incredibly sleepy. You feel like it's going to be impossible for you to stay awake and write another note. It's just going to be physically impossible. Then what happens? By 7 or 8 o'clock in the morning, you start feeling more alert. You get what people call a second wind. You become more alert. Now, why is this? If sleep is homeostatic, why doesn't it continue to accumulate, your drive continue to accumulate? Well, the reason is because we have another process, and it's called a circadian process. Deep within the mammalian brain, there's a cluster of neurons called the suprachiasmatic nucleus that is your sleep-wake clock. It puts out, it's a marker that puts, it generates a signal that has a period of approximately 24 hours that counteracts the sleep homeostatic process. So at 4 o'clock in the morning, the circadian rhythm, this sleep-wake clock is low, and your sleep-wake drive is very high, so you are very, very sleepy. But after 4 o'clock, between 4 and 6, the circadian rhythm, which has been counteracting your sleep accumulation, starts to increase, and your brain is getting this wake-up signal, so you start to become alert. And your net level of sleepiness is a aggregation, a sum, if you will, of the circadian drive to be awake versus the homeostatic drive to be asleep. So by 7 or 8 in the morning, when that circadian process is starting to take off, your body temperature is starting to rise, and you are more alert than you were at 4 o'clock, even though your homeostatic drive has continued to accumulate. And the sleepiness that you have is a net, it's an aggregation of this circadian cycle, the phase position of that circadian cycle, and your homeostatic drive for sleep. So that's why you have the second wind, and you can actually stay awake for grand rounds at 8 o'clock in the morning, even though you were fighting to stay awake at 4 o'clock, 4 hours earlier. Now, there's a third principle that often isn't considered in the classes of sleep mechanisms, but I think it's a very important principle, and that's the autonomic principle, that sleep propensity is modulated by your level of arousal. And when you think of everything we do, all the things we classify as fatigue countermeasures, they all involve increasing sympathetic arousal. So if you're trying to stay awake, what do? You take caffeine, and that increases sympathetic arousal. You can crank down the car window and get a blast of cold air. That's going to increase sympathetic arousal. You can stand on one foot. If you jump on one foot, you're increasing sympathetic arousal. All these things that we utilize as fatigue countermeasures, which we know in the long run are not going to solve the problem, but in the short run, they give us a little boost in our alertness. These are all driven by the autonomic nervous system. They're all involve enhancing sympathetic arousal to counteract the effects of the homeostatic accumulation of the need for sleep, as well as the circadian phase position. So those are the three basic sleep mechanisms. And when we think about what we do to treat sleep problems, actually that maps very nicely into these three classes of mechanisms. So what do we do in terms of trying to modulate the duration of sleep, the homeostatic drive for sleep? Well, we fool around with the amount of sleep that people get, and that's how we can adjust that. When we look at treatments that involve treatments for sleep disorders that involve sleep timing, we can monkey around with that by exposing patients to light or exposing them to darkness, or else using melatonin and endogenous this hormone that is sensitive to the darkness in the environment. When we think about autonomic mechanisms that we use to regulate sleep or wake, we can enhance alertness with sympathomimetic substances like caffeine, or we can dampen autonomic arousal with relaxation and meditation. So these are all ways we modulate the sleep-wake state, the treatments that we have for sleep disorders. Now, when we look at how we measure sleep in the lab, the basic measurements we use to define sleep stages haven't changed for 60 years. We look at the brain waves, the EEG signals, that's one important index, and we generally derive that from the scalp. The sleep stages are defined by the EEG activity under the central leads. We also look at eye movements, the left and right eyes. We have little electrodes attached to them, and we look at electrical muscle activity, and we generally derive that from the chin. And these are the three parameters we use to define sleep stages. And we've used those parameters for the past 60 years or so. When we look at these things, we notice that there's a progressive change across the course of sleep that we divide into sleep stages. And when we look at the EEG over the course of these sleep stages, when you're awake, and hopefully you're all in an awake state now, your brain, if you were to close your eyes, your brain would be generating a rhythm of approximately 8 to 12 cycles per second, the alpha rhythm, and that's the state of relaxed alertness. As you start to drift off to sleep, if you had your eyes closed, your brain would downshift to a dominant rhythm of between 4 and 8 cycles per second, or in the theta range, and we call that stage 1 sleep, and this is really an intermediate stage. If I were to nudge you on the shoulder and say, are you awake? You say, yeah, sure, I'm awake, but actually, and some behavioral measures would suggest you're awake, and some other electrographic measures would suggest you're asleep. So this is a transitional stage. Then we get into stage 2 sleep. In stage 2 sleep, your brain starts generating these little bursts of voltage called sleep spindles, and that's a marker of stage 2 sleep. About half of the normal adult sleep consists of stage 2 sleep. Then we go on to what used to be called stages 3 and 4. Now they're lumped together as stage N3, and these consist of the slow wave stages of sleep. And we think that the slow wave stages of sleep are what are the most restorative phases of sleep. Now your brain does this for about 80 minutes at the beginning of your sleep cycle, and then what happens? Your brain gets bored, it gets tired, and it wants to do something interesting. So it hits the channel shifter and it turns on what? A dream, a period of rapid eye movement sleep. During the REM phase of sleep, your brain is extremely active. Actually, if you look at cerebral glucose utilization, it's 25% higher than it is in wakefulness. Your brain is extremely active, but your muscles are functionally paralyzed, and that prevents you from getting up and running around. So you go into this phase of sleep called REM sleep. And these phases alternate every 90 minutes throughout the night. And so we have a progression of cycles that have about a 90-minute periodicity. The amount of REM sleep decreases over the course of the night, increases over the course of the night. The amount of slow wave sleep, or deep non-REM sleep, decreases. The amount of slow wave sleep you're getting is proportional to the amount of sleep drive that you've accumulated. So the longer you're awake, the more slow wave activity we'll see in the EEG. But as that starts to dissipate over the course of the night, you kind of pay down your sleep debt. And by morning time, you're alternating between these REM phase of sleep, where your brain is extremely active, and a lighter version of the non-REM phase of sleep. These names, REM and non-REM, are really artifacts of how we discovered sleep 60 years ago, when a neurophysiologist named Kleitman at the University of Chicago started to measure brain activity and various physiological parameters during sleep. Kleitman attached electrodes outside the eyes and noticed the eyes were darting back and forth every 90 minutes during sleep, and he decided to call that phase of sleep rapid eye movement sleep. Now, Kleitman was a Russian immigrant. He had a brilliant mind for physiology, but he didn't have a great gift for the English language, so he decided to call this REM sleep. And then his student said, Dr. Kleitman, what do we call the other 75% of sleep? And he said, well, let's just call that the phase of sleep when your eyes aren't moving around rapidly. So we call it non-REM sleep. And this is so stupid. I mean, why do we, can you imagine? Well, we have waking, and then we have the period where you're not waking. Well, so we have this phase of sleep where your eyes are moving around, and then where your eyes aren't moving around. And this is really simply an artifact of how we were measuring things 60 years ago. The eyes were the part of the nervous system that's kind of hanging out there, and it was really easy to measure with our technology 60 years ago. If Kleitman had stuck in a probe into the middle ear muscle, he would have seen that middle ear muscle activity varies every 90 minutes, just with the way the REM sleep happens. And then we would have middle ear muscle activity sleep, or MEM sleep. So there's nothing special about REM sleep. All these other aspects of our physiology were changing at the same time. And there's nothing really unique about the eye movements, but the eye movements were just the part of the brain that was hanging out there that was easy for Kleckman to observe 60 years ago, and that's why we call it REM sleep. And then we call the other stuff non-REM sleep for no good reason at all. It's just the other part of the
If you could choose a new name for the two cycles based on the new research after 60 years, how would you rename it?
You know how stupid it is that's kind of an obvious thing. But we are so stuck in our nomenclature that we've changed this to REM, we call that stage R, and non-REM we call stage N. You know? And in stage N we see these things called K complexes, and actually nobody knows where the term K comes from. These old men have arguments about it and say, you know, it's some German name, Koffel or something, but nobody agrees. It's remarkable. So we don't have any good, there's no good rational basis for these questions. But these names are incredibly, you talk to your patients all the time, they come in and say, doctor, I need more REM sleep. What do you mean you need more REM sleep? Okay, anyway.
Does your body temperature fall during sleep?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
Yeah, so it's going to tend to fall as you sleep, and body temperature is directly determined by circadian phase. Okay. So it will fall during sleep, and by 4 o'clock in the morning when your circadian phase is starting to turn into arousal, it'll start to go up.
Okay.
So actually at the end of the sleep period, it's starting to rise. And what we see over the course of the lifespan, and this is important, of course, if we're talking about geriatrics, we see an increase in stage one sleep, the transitional phase of sleep. Slow wave sleep decreases a lot as we age, and so after age 50, it's dropped a lot. REM sleep is relatively conserved until late life. Amount of waking during sleep, what's labeled there as WASO, or wakefulness after sleep onset, that increases a lot as we age. And so, of course, older patients will complain about increased amount of wakefulness during night. And that's what we see if we plot sleep over the lifespan. Sleep is very different, and it's very different in all sorts of different organisms. If they had more time, I could tell you all sorts of interesting things. If you were a dolphin, how would you sleep? You're a mammal, you know, you have to breathe. If you were to sleep both hemispheres at the same time, you'd sink like a stone to the bottom of the sea, you'd never reproduce, and we'd never have anybody to play with at SeaWorld, it would be terrible. So dolphins and seals have come up with this marvelous adaptation. They sleep one hemisphere at a time. So one hemisphere is asleep, the other one's awake. Their left hemisphere is awake, the right hemisphere is asleep, the right fins are moving like this, and they rotate around like that. And then they switch after 90 minutes, and the left hemisphere is awake, and the left fins are starting to move like that. And I'm sure it's reversed in the southern hemisphere. But this is a marvelous adaptation. And it shows you how plastic sleep is, actually. There's some very interesting properties of sleep that are illustrated
by
dolphins.
So do they sleep a lot, though?
Or they sleep just like humans?
Yeah.
Yeah. They have a big brain, they need to sleep, but they do it one hemisphere at a time. So it's a very interesting adaptation. Organisms, creatures, mammals that have a long childhood tend to have more sleep and more rapid eye movement sleep early on. We think that rapid eye movement sleep may be involved in early neural programming and organization. So cats that have maternal care, cats and rats, have a lot of REM sleep in infancy, and then it decreases as they approach adulthood. An animal like a guinea pig, which actually has very little in the way of maternal care, has very little REM sleep. The longer childhood is, the more a species is what we call altricial versus precocial, the longer and the greater the amount of REM sleep. I know this for a fact because my children are still not, they have a very long childhood, they're into their 20s and they're still not self-sufficient. They get a lot of sleep. They've always had a lot of REM sleep because they're very busy reprogramming their brains and everything like that. So species that have prolonged childhoods have a great deal of REM sleep. It's just an interesting part of the way our biology works. And it's correlated with the length of childhood. Children also, there's some interesting features of sleep that change over the course of adulthood or over the course of the lifespan. Of course, newborns alternate between sleep and wake in a very chaotic kind of pattern. By 1 year of age, you have a pattern of nighttime sleep that tends to be more established, and we get 1 or 2 daytime naps. By preschool age, age 4 or 5, of course, we have kind of a biphasic pattern where the children will have a nap in the early afternoon, but they tend to have consolidated sleep at night. And by age 10, we tend to be monophasic. We have one extended period of sleep at night. And that continues through adulthood. But we do have a natural tendency towards biphasic sleep. If we were giving this lecture 200 miles south of here, the siesta is part of culture. It's also part of our biology. There's a normal decrease in alertness in the early afternoon. And if we were to look at sleep in nature, it actually would look more biphasic than the monophasic sleep that we have. It's part of our typical life. So when the drug companies try to encourage you to have people asleep all night and awake all day, that's really, in some sense, an artifact of our culture. And in many cultures that are a period of sleep in the afternoon is actually resonant with our biology and with the natural pattern of our sleep-wake cycle. And again, REM sleep decreases over the course of early development and is conserved throughout most of adulthood. But if we look at fetuses, for example, about 12 hours out of 24 is spent in this REM sleep. So REM sleep seems to have something again to do with neural reprogramming. If we look at the natural period of sleep, it's actually a little longer than 24 hours. If we put you in an environment with no time cues, your sleep-wake clock will run into about a little over 25 hours. So in a week's time, you gain about 8 hours. It's not because we came from another planet or anything like that. This is just part of the natural sleep-wake pattern. And we have to adapt our sleep-wake pattern to conform to 24 hours. And that means locking it to the circadian phase. We have to shift that in our culture. We have to move it forward or back every spring and every fall in order to accommodate the changes in the scheduling of our waking activities. Loss of sleep actually contributes to a lot of accidents. If we look at some of the most major scale industrial accidents in the past 50 years, the Exxon Valdez oil tanker accident in Alaska, what caused that accident? The first question everybody asked was the captain drunk? Well, he wasn't drinking. What was the captain doing? He was asleep. What was the first mate doing at the time the Valdez ran aground? He was asleep. What was the second mate doing? He was asleep. At the most dangerous point in its departure from the harbor, it was being piloted by an inexperienced third mate. Same thing with the Chernobyl nuclear power plant accident. Did this happen at 4 o'clock in the afternoon? No, it happened at 3 o'clock in the morning. Again, it was a technical error that occurred. It was being monitored by a sleepy technician who made a mistake in how he responded. And a huge industrial accident happened as a result. So these problems come up all the time. I don't think it was any accident that the Asiana airline that crashed in San Francisco crashed after the pilots had been up, the whole crew had been up for 12 hours overnight. Fatigue is being considered as one of the factors that the NTSB is looking into as a possible explanation for that accident. Okay, let me talk about obstructive sleep apnea a little bit. This is, again, the most common reason that somebody gets referred to a sleep specialist. Common complaints that people come into that are referred for suspected sleep apnea. Patients complain about non-restorative sleep. They wake up in the morning, they feel as tired as when they went to bed. They complain about morning headaches, increased daytime sleepiness, depression, irritability, problems with concentration and memory. Again, I say 50% of the patients that present to a sleep doctor have come to a primary care doctor and they said, I have no energy, I'm moody, and what happens? They get prescribed an antidepressant. And they come back in 2 months and they say, I have no energy, I'm moody, and now I have erectile dysfunction or something. So this is a very common pattern in primary care. These symptoms present and they're treated with an antidepressant, which actually, the underlying problem is actually a sleep disorder. And just to underline the point here, if you were to take a history of a patient like this and you invited the bed partner into the consulting room, you would learn very quickly what the underlying problem is. Patients are not always very accurate in describing a sleep problem because what's happening, of course, they're asleep when the problem is occurring. If you do have an opportunity to interrogate a bedtime partner as part of getting a history, that can be extremely informative. And so I would certainly consider that if you have a patient in the waiting room and you want to ask about a sleep problem, if there is a bed partner out there, then invite them in to be part of the interview. Again, untreated sleep apnea has been linked to a variety of cardiovascular disorders, including hypertension, MIs, congestive heart failure, and stroke. What is sleep apnea? Basically, when we fall asleep, all the muscles in the body relax, including in the airway. This shows a man breathing normally during sleep. When the soft palate starts to relax and vibrate, that's what the other people in the room may hear is snoring, as you can see in that lower illustration. If the soft palate relaxes and collapses closed, then there's no oxygen going to the lungs. Oxygen drops, carbon dioxide goes up into the brain, generates a signal, says wake up, and the patient goes, starts breathing again. This can happen dozens or hundreds of times a night. This is what happens when we observe this in the laboratory. We have a number of signals that we're looking at, including EEG, heart rate. We look at leg movements. Most importantly, in terms of looking for sleep apnea, we look at airflow, and we look at respiratory effort. In this picture, we see airflow has dropped to nothing there. Effort is continuing in this sinusoidal form here. We see oxygen saturation dropping until the patient's brain generates a signal that says wake up, and we see an arousal. And again, this can happen hundreds of times a night without the patient being aware of it. This is just an illustration of what we see in central sleep apnea, a somewhat less common situation, but it comes up often. It comes up more often in geriatric populations. But in central sleep apnea, we see a loss of airflow, but it's accompanied by a decrease in or a cessation of respiratory effort. And oftentimes we'll see this occur in a periodic pattern like this. This can be associated, most commonly it's actually seen in situations associated with heart failure. That's one of the most common reasons people present with a central sleep apnea. And it requires a somewhat different approach in terms of treatment. Okay, screening patients for OSA, if you can remember anything out of this, you should just keep this in mind. If you have, really you can think about asking for three questions. Does the patient snore? Do they have excessive sleepiness? And do they have a BMI over 30 or hypertension? If you answer yes to two of those three, then you have high pretest probability for sleep apnea. You need to generate a sleep referral. And I hesitate to tell you that because I have hundreds of patients waiting for evaluations. But you can see, I mean, if you were to ask patients in your clinic, you'd end up, you'd be generating a lot of business for the sleep clinic. And that's, in fact, if you apply this rule, over half the people that you were to identify will have polygraphically confirmed sleep apnea. So it's a common disorder. How do we assess sleepiness? There's a standard test called the Epworth Sleepiness Scale. It's scored 0 to 24. Each question is scored on a 0 to 3 scale. How likely are you to doze off? Sitting and reading, watching television, sitting and active in a public place, as a passenger in a car for an hour without a break, lying down to rest when circumstances permit, sitting and talking with someone, sitting quietly after lunch in a car while stopped for a few minutes in traffic. You can do this if you're in your office and you just type Epworth in Google, it'll generate a copy of this questionnaire, and you can either fill it out with the patient or have the patient fill it out in the waiting room. It takes 3 or 4 minutes. If you get a score over 8, you have a sleepy patient. If you've taken that yourself, then you may need to generate a referral for yourself. Okay. Cardiovascular consequences, we know that, as I mentioned, hypertension, stroke, pulmonary hypertension, cardiac arrhythmias are all more common in patients with untreated sleep apnea. There's a very interesting study was performed. This was looking at a large cohort being followed for cardiovascular disease. These were mostly older patients. It's actually a good sample to look at in terms of understanding the relationship between sleep apnea and some cardiovascular outcomes. And in this particular case, they took the patients and they broke them down into quartiles. How much apnea and hypotonia per hour they saw, 0 to 1.3, so that's kind of our baseline. These are people with no apneas, hypopneas, basically 1.4 to 4.4. These are actually people that are subclinical. So our cutoff is 5 events an hour. So none of these people would be identified as having sleep apnea. 4.4 to 11 would be mild. 11 is still, or 11, greater than 11 is still in the mild range. But this is a, these are cut points that were generated to come up with roughly equal numbers of patients in the four quartiles. And what you see here is the number of patients that have diabetes, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, or congestive heart failure. And you can see these numbers start to go up even at the subclinical level, which is a little disturbing. But what it means is that patients, even with mild disease, sleep apnea, have a higher risk for a variety of cardiovascular problems. And these are actually levels of disease that don't even qualify by Medicare for being treated. Now, if you're looking at this, you may say, well, but isn't a lot of this driven by other factors like obesity? So let me show you an odds table that kind of clarifies this. This is adjusted risk. And these are odds that are adjusted for age, sex, race, smoking, diabetes, hypertension, hypertension medications, blood pressure, BMI, cholesterol, and HDL. So this is adjusting for all the other risk factors. And you can see there's still an increase in risk associated with not breathing during sleep. Congestive heart failure, cardiovascular disease, and stroke, all even at mild levels, even after you've controlled for all these other factors, you see increased increments in risk, which is kind of obvious. I tell my patients in the intake, breathing is good. Not breathing is not good. Doctors agree.
So the mechanism behind that would be mostly just hypoxia leading to, I don't know, oxidative stress.
I think there are probably several different mechanisms. And of course, data like this are agnostic as far as what the mechanism is. But we know that hypoxemia may be a factor, and the other is simply repetitive sympathetic arousal, which is probably driving a lot of cardiovascular morbidity just by itself.
Yeah.
And both of these are probably independent factors that are contributing to the increased risk.
So, because we have seen a sleep apnea in theme individuals.
Yeah.
Not everybody, I mean, you have this kind of image of everybody that is obese may be a high risk. I have had two elders that have very low BMIs and they have obstructive sleep apnea.
I have a lot of normal weight patients.
Exactly. So I think that's a myth that we need to...
I saw a patient last week who's a triathlete that has moderately severe sleep apnea.
Wow, that's crazy.
I've tested a 60-year-old man who actually works here who runs marathons.
Is that the sympathetic arousal maybe theory in those individuals?
Well, I think what it comes to is that anything that is associated with a narrow airway can cause this problem, or a floppy airway. Now, in our culture, the most common reason to have a small airway is to have a big neck and to be obese. But there are all sorts of other factors that may be involved. And so I have relatively young patients, I have healthy patients at normal body weights that have significant sleep apnea. And so if you restrict yourself simply to looking for patients that are obese, you're going to be missing a lot of patients. If you need to look for sleepy patients, and certainly a normal weight patient that's hypertensive, you would have some concerns with that. So unfortunately, there are a number of risk factors. And simply to look for a Pickwickian obese male, you're going to be missing a lot of patients there.
I have one other question, sorry.
Yeah.
Is there any role for measuring the neck circumference?
Neck circumference is actually, if you're trying to treat a Medicare patient, you have to measure neck circumference.
Oh, okay.
Neck circumference is an anatomic marker, is the best predictor of risk for sleep apnea.
Oh, okay.
And what is the cutoff?
The only, yeah, I don't know.
The cutoffs that have been indicated, basically 15 and a half inches for a woman, 16 and a half for a man.
Okay.
I've got a 17 and a half inch shirt. I'm at risk.
Okay, thank you. Well, only I'm studying for the boards, and I had a question on that, and they said the neck circumference is this, and I'm like, is that bigger? But now I know, 16 and a half for men.
Okay. Women larger 15, than men.
16 and a half for women,
okay.
16 and a half
16 for men.
Women have some advantages since you have basically visceral fat is what's going to be your risk factor. Since women have a different, body distribution, but any adipose tissue in the neck is going to reduce your airway diameter, and that's going to be a risk. Okay. So we treat sleep apnea, we see improvements in hypertension, improvements in left ventricular function, improve survival, and improve well-being, not least significant by any means. Okay. Compliance is a big issue with sleep apnea. Patients 65 to 90% tell us that they use the machines. If we actually look at objective measures, it's really disturbing. Now, this is probably true. I mean, a lot of you, I mean, one problem I have in sleep medicine is I can objectively measure whether a patient's using their treatment. You can't tell whether they're taking their pills every night or whatever. I can look at whether they're actually using their equipment. In fact, I put in a proposal. All of our machines have technology that measures how much the patient are using it. I've got a proposal in for a wireless modem for all the patients in the VA. So I'm going to know whether they're sleeping or whether they're awake all the time. I mean, this is really scary. But, you know, we live in the surveillance state. And, you know, this is just it's a very interesting application of this technology. But if you look at how often the patients are using the machine as prescribed effectively, unfortunately, it's right around 25% actually use it. And it's being used and generating appropriate levels of efficacy with use. That's rather depressing. We have a big window of 75% that we can target to improve outcomes in treating patients.
So what are the most common complaints of lack of compliance with that? I mean, we hear a lot in our offices, but
I'm
you
sure
are
you
an
do.
Expert, so what are the reasons you hear and how you tackle them?
Okay, that's a really good question. The most common problem is the mask interface. But I tell my patients, if God made one nose, I would have one mask. And so we have 60 different interfaces. If you look at the number of styles of interface and the number of brands and the number of sizes, it's tremendous. And finding the right interface is the most critical thing in solving the patient's problem. Actually, that's very critical. What we do in the lab, of course, is finding the right pressure. All the machines we issue through VA now have what we call auto-adjusting features, so we can actually set a range of pressures rather than a prescribed pressure, and the machine will hunt and try to find the right pressure for them. That's a big advantage. It costs a little more per machine, but I've found that we can probably get better compliance with that. And we also get better information in terms of how the patients do with it. So those are some of the things. The other thing is finding the right machine for the patient. So I'm talking about CPAP in general here. But if a patient requires high pressures, they may require a BiPAP machine. I have other patients that we see routinely that are being treated with CPAP where actually they don't need CPAP. They need a different device like a servo ventilator because they have some central sleep apnea. So these patients are actually being mistreated by applying continuous pressure. But for the majority of patients, finding the right interface is important. Getting adequate humidification with the device is very important. If you use CPAP without humidity, it's like breathing, like sticking your head out the window, driving 60 miles an hour with your mouth open. This is going to feel terrible. But with appropriate heat and humidification, it can be much more comfortable. These are the kinds of problems that an adequately trained respiratory therapist can solve with the patient. If you're referring a patient for treatment, it's very important that the CPAP therapist take the time to work with the patient to achieve good adherence and solve these problems. If you refer them to a dealer that hands them a box and runs their credit card, the person is just not doing the job that's required. Yes?
Have you ever heard someone complain of suffocation? Because that's what I have heard a lot of patients tell me, that I feel suffocated.
Well, there are a couple issues with that. So when they're complaining about suffocation, the first thing you'd be thinking about is anxiety. And that is very amenable to a short-term behavioral treatment where you teach them to put the mask over their nose for 60 seconds, put their mask over the nose for 2 minutes and gradually increase the amount of pressure. This is something that the CPAP therapist should actually do. What I found that's very helpful is to actually have them do that at home when they're relaxing, watching television. If their attention is deployed outward, then they will do much better with this. If their attention is totally focused on interoceptive cues, then they put the mask on and they're immediately suffocation panic will set in, because this is a very primal reflex that we have. You put something over
yes.
your face, and you're every, you know, we are primed to see that, the suffocation. But actually, what you have to tell the patient, of course, is no, you're suffocating without the CPAP. The CPAP is actually going to help you breathe. But you do have to overcome this primal suffocation reflex that we have. And again, that can be done by a combination of things. It's graded exposure plus diverting attention outward. And we can solve that problem most of the time. The other thing, it's another related complaint that patients will sometimes tell you is air hunger. It feels like they're just not getting enough air. Some of those patients are actually not being treated appropriately. They don't need CPAP. They may need BiPAP or one of these other devices we have called a servo-ventilator, where we can instantaneously change the amount of pressure that's being applied because they have some central sleep apnea. So the patient complains, no, it doesn't have anything to do with anxiety. I just feel like I'm not getting enough air, and it feels that way all the time. That may be that kind of a problem, and we need to reevaluate in the sleep lab and try a different kind of air pressure technology. So these are really common problems. Okay. I'm sure I'm running out of time.
It's got 15, 20 minutes if you want.
Okay. All right. Restless legs. Another common problem, discomfort in both legs, tingling, tension, aching. These symptoms occur at rest. They vary in severity. They can be partially or completely relieved by manipulating the limbs or standing up and walking around. Other neurologic symptoms are generally absent. This was first described by Thomas Willis, who did this, the Circle of Willis. This is a wonderful Elizabethan description of the disorder. I haven't found anything better in the past 300 years. But wherefore to some, when being in bed, they betake themselves to sleep. Presently, in the arms and legs, leaping and contractions of the tendons, and some great restlessness and tossing of their members ensue, but the disease are no more able to sleep than if they were in a place of greatest torture. That's what these patients are experiencing. Okay, so that was Thomas Willis in 1672. The disorder was rediscovered by Carl Axel Ekblom, who was narcissistic enough to call it Ekblom disease and ignored Willis. Modern terminology either calls it restless leg syndrome or Willis-Ekblom disease, in recognition of both Willis and Ekblom. Willis described the syndrome also and divided it into two categories, the sensory and painful RLS variation. So sensory being a kind of paresthesias in the limbs, and then painful limbs associated with what he called asthenia crurum dolorosa. Again, these are the criteria that the International Restless Leg Syndrome Society has come up with. An irresistible urge to move the limbs. Symptoms are worse exclusively or presently at rest. It's partially or completely removed with movement. And the symptoms have a circadian pattern. They're worse in the evening or at night. When we look at this in the lab, we'll see periodic limb movements in the polysomnogram, these little twitches that generally occur in one or both lower extremities with a very, oftentimes a very remarkable periodicity of 20 to 30 seconds. In some patients, this just seems like it's driven by a clock. It's remarkably periodic. Periodic limb movements during sleep, basically over 90% of patients with restless legs will have periodic limb movements on the polysomnogram, but there are many patients who have periodic limb movements during sleep that actually don't have any restless leg symptoms. And this can be a normal variant. It doesn't necessarily require any treatment. If the periodic limb movements during sleep are associated with repetitive arousals, then that's probably going to be increase the likelihood that you have symptoms and you are going to require treatment. This does tend to have a familial pattern. Again, these are some of the things that patients will describe. Creepy, aching, burning, crawling, tingling, cramping. We tend to divide restless legs into either idiopathic RLS or secondary RLS. Secondary RLS is associated with syndromes of iron deficiency. And again, this increases with age. If we look at patients over 65, 40% of them will have periodic limb movements on the polysomnogram. Again, not all those patients are symptomatic. Actually, the more of them are symptomatic. But these leg jerks tend to be increasingly manifest as we age. If we look at things like anemia in pregnancy, the numbers go up. Iron deficiency is associated with an increased risk for restless legs. When we observe this in the patients clinically, in the clinic, we'll generally draw a ferritin level. A ferritin level, like this miswritten, it should be nanograms per milliliter. 50 nanograms per milliliter or less is going to be a pathologically low level of ferritin. And generally, that would be an indication for iron supplementation. Generally, we do it with vitamin C to facilitate absorption. Interestingly enough, if you give patients iron intravenously, and this is not done clinically, but if you give this intravenously, you'll get relief of far less for months afterwards. So there's something involved in iron storage here that seems responsive to a intravenous treatment, even though this is not generally done clinically. Things that will make RLS worse: antidepressants, antihypertensives, antiemetics, caffeine at bedtime, alcohol, all these things can contribute to this. One thing I see a lot in primary care in psychiatry, people will treat restless legs by giving them antidepressants. You're making the problem worse, please, okay? And the standard treatments are dopamine agonists, or pinerol, or pramipexole, and it all depends. Both of those are equipotent as far as I'm concerned. My judgment in clinic is directed by the pharmacoeconomics. It's whatever the VA pharmacy seems to be providing. With the Cinemet, we used to use this all the time. Cinemet, of course, you can get augmentation with it, which is a potential problem, and actually it's a second line of treatment for that reason. The dopamine agonists seem to be associated with less likelihood of sensitizing the dopamine receptors, and so they would be the front line of treatment now rather than the Cinemet. If you have painful RLS, you may get in a situation where codeine or codeine derivatives are helpful. If you have a lot of insomnia associated with RLS, then benzodiazepines such as clonazepam or gabapentin, GABA agonists will be considered useful for treatment. I'm going to talk a little about an interesting disorder. I saw a man with this morning, actually, Dr. White and I did in clinic. REM sleep behavior disorder. This is a loss of motor atonia during REM sleep with the emergence of vigorous, often complex behaviors in the absence of epilepsy. This is common in older men. REM sleep, of course, is also known as paradoxical or active sleep. I mentioned that we have high levels of cerebral blood flow, increased oxygen consumption, and a desynchronized low voltage EEG. So your brain is wide awake during REM sleep, but your muscles are all functionally paralyzed. What were to happen if you have this atonia that's part of normal REM sleep, and that's generated by these neurons in the dorsolateral pons that project to the medial medullary reticular formation, and they hyperpolarize during rapid eye movement sleep, and that hyperpolarization results in a postsynaptic inhibition of spinal motor neurons, and that prevents you from getting up and walking around. Now, if those centers are disrupted by a neurodegenerative disease, you can be in REM sleep, and this person is. These are eye movements here, and it's a REM-EEG there, and all of a sudden he develops these phasic bursts of muscle activity, and this is an individual that's actually getting up and starting to swing his arms around and acting out his dreams. It's interesting because I can't think of another example of a situation there. This was understood, the laboratory model for this was identified long before the clinical syndrome was recognized. Michel Gervais in France created a model for this disorder by lesioning the pontine brain of cats in 1965, but the clinical disorder wasn't identified until 20 years after that. These cats that Gervais was lesioning would get up during REM sleep and start hallucinating and start chasing butterflies and things like that, it seemed like. What we see in patients with this is variable. Laughing, yelling, talking, gesturing, swearing, getting up, jumping out of bed, crawling, running. These patients generally present if a bed partner is complaining or as a result of self-injury. Okay. What's interesting in terms of the pathology for this is we come to recognize that this is probably a prodromal feature of Parkinson's disease. Approximately, it affects overall about 0.5% of elderly males. 50% of the patients that are affected will develop Parkinsonian symptoms within 5 years. 40% of patients with a movement disorders clinics actually have REM sleep behavior disorder. But it doesn't always come up in clinical interviews because, again, doctors just don't ask about sleep. You know, if you were to ask your patients in a movement disorders clinic about sleep, you know, about 4 out of 10 would be complaining about something that sounds like RBD. If we have a patient with multisystem atrophy, 95% of those patients have RVED. But I've looked at clinical descriptions of this, and I've seen incidence rates from 10% to 100%. Literally, the range couldn't be any higher. But that range is simply an artifact of whether or not the doctor's asking about what's going on during sleep. Okay. Interestingly enough, this drug responds extremely well to clonazepam. About 80% of patients report partial or complete relief with clonazepam. So if you can recognize this, it does respond very well to relatively low doses of clonazepam. I was going to talk about insomnia, but I'm going to brush ahead a little bit. I'm going to talk about a case which actually relates a lot to insomnia. And I think that would be a more productive use of our time. So this is a case that this could walk in your clinic any day. A 73-year-old woman presents with difficulties initiating and maintaining sleep for many years. She's presenting because her cardiologist is worried about a fall that she's had and several falls she's described. This is a woman that actually described a phase-delayed pattern of sleep for many years. She would go to bed at 2 a.m. to 3 a.m. and then wake up around noon. And this was reinforced because she was actually a nurse and she worked nights as a nurse for many years. This pattern changed a couple of years ago, though. This phase-delayed pattern for many years, and then it shifted to a phase-advanced pattern after she had an episode of prednisone-induced psychosis 5 years ago. And she comes to see me now, and she tells me she goes to bed at 6 o'clock in the evening, and she wakes up at 1 to 2 o'clock, and she has difficulty returning to sleep, which actually is not surprising. If you were able to fall asleep at 6, and you wake up after 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock, you've had, you know, 7 or 8 hours of sleep. But she thinks this is a problem. Well, it is a problem. What does she do to try to deal with the problem? She takes 300 milligrams of modafinil at 4 o'clock in the morning, and then she gets up finally at 5 or 6 o'clock. She describes restless sleep, but she does not describe restless legs. No reports of leg jerks during sleep. She wakes up a lot during sleep. She was treated with Ambien, not surprisingly, and she had a parasomnia episode. She actually got up, drove to the store, bought a pack of cigarettes, and came home and had no memory of doing it at all. So Ambien, that was kind of a problem for her. Okay. And she also has episodes of nocturnal eating with Ambien, so we were concerned about that. She described episodes of waking up, choking her, gasping, back breathing during sleep, dry mouth upon awakening, daytime fatigue and tiredness. But she denies any excessive daytime sleepiness. She has an Epworth sleepiness scale of 0. Her complaints are insomnia. In terms of her medical history, she has COPD, she has cardiovascular disease, osteoarthritis, BGD, and depression, mild hypoxemia. She sleeps with oxygen at night. She has a questionable stroke from 2004. A family history that's positive for depression but negative for sleep disorders. Surgical history basically not contributory. On a lot of drugs, she may be a ferritin, macrodentin. Some of the more interesting ones, she's on modafinil 300 milligrams, takes Ambien as needed. I would question whether it's ever really needed for her. Also takes Xanax occasionally. A lot of different drugs. She's divorced, she has two adult children. Again, she's a retired nurse, had a very heavy smoking history, but now she says she smokes she's a nurse. She wasn't 8 or 9, it's 8.9 cigarettes a day, she told me. And this is one, also, I never get a history of the number of milliliters. She drinks 550 milliliters of wine a night. Okay, but again, she's a former nurse. So we did a sleep study, and what do we find? This is really interesting. So this is a woman that's complaining about terrible insomnia. We do a sleep study, 436 minutes of sleep and 464 minutes. That's a sleep efficiency of 94%. Stone cold normal, that was great, okay? Sleep latency of 1.5 minutes. This is a woman who's complaining about insomnia. REM latency was long, 227 minutes, but she's on these antidepressant drugs that would explain the prolonged REM latency. Normal amount of stage 10 wind sleep. Normal amount of stage N3 sleep, decreased amount of REM sleep, and again, that goes along with the REM suppressing effects of antidepressant medications. Her sleep, however, even though it's grossly relatively normal, was very unstable. She had 84 stage changes, she had 18 brief awakenings, and she had 121.5 arousals for an hour. These were mostly related to mild respiratory events. She had 34 hypotonia, she had 94 what we call respiratory effort related arousal, arrears. And what arrears is, this is an attenuation of airflow followed by an arousal, but there's no oxygen drop. So it doesn't get scored as a hypopnea. But a sleep doctor will count this because it does tell us something about respiratory instability. The respiratory disturbance index then is 17.9, which is in the moderately severe range, but these are not associated with big drops in oxygen saturation. Average O2, however, was low, but this is a woman with like a 50-year smoking history. 8.4% during wakefulness, 91% during REM sleep. And desaturations that were 91-89%, so actually, see, most of these events don't get counted as apneas or hypopneas because the drop in saturation is only 2%. It has to be 4% according to Medicare. So she has mild to moderate sleep apnea. She has hypoxemia, and she has what I call a phase advanced circadian rhythm. She's going to bed at 6 o'clock and waking up at 9. She also has insomnia, I think, associated with her long-term mood disturbance. How are we going to treat this? Well, there are a couple things that I wanted to do. I wanted to put her back on the CPAP device. She had tried CPAP before, but she didn't like the mask, and so she discontinued it. What we saw in the polysomnogram was she was having a lot of arousals during sleep, and this actually fit with her subjective report. So even though her total sleep time was normal, it was very fragmented, so I wanted to start the CPAP again. I thought we could probably discontinue the supplemental oxygen if we could keep her oxygen in above 90% by keeping her airway stable. For insomnia, we talked a lot about sleep hygiene. What I wanted to do is, one of the basic things we do in sleep medicine for insomnia is we actually restrict time in bed. We say, you can't spend 10 hours in bed. You're going to spend 6 to 8 hours in bed. This is where I become the sleep Nazi, what I'm saying, okay? You're going to spend less time in bed. We're going to treat your insomnia because your problem is not difficulty. Your problem is sleep fragmentation. If I can give you 6 hours of sleep, you can wake up and feel refreshed. That's better than having 6 hours of sleep distributed over 10 or 18 hours. So we restrict time in bed. We teach you to use relaxation rituals rather than alcohol and Xanax. We reduce benzodiazepines and sedating antidepressants. For circadian phase advance, we're going to change. She was taking modafinil at 4 o'clock. I told her to reduce the dose to 100 milligrams and take it at 7 o'clock. And then also we want to develop a pattern where she's exposed to light, because if she's exposed to light, she's probably not going to need the modafinil anymore. So we tell her to get some light exercise in the morning. And those are some of the things that I do to treat a polymorbid sleep problem. So this is a woman with a circadian rhythm disturbance with a sleep disordered breathing with insomnia. It's probably related to a long-term psychiatric disorder as well as substance use. We change all those things and we can actually have a good outcome here. So in conclusion, sleep disorders are common. Sleep disorders are underdiagnosed and sleep disorders are treatable. And with that, I'll stop and take any questions. Yes, sir.
Do most persons who snore also have sleep apnea?
Snoring, not necessarily. So basically, irregular snoring, if they're not holding their breath during sleep, then they're not having sleep apnea. So I tell patients that snoring is a marital problem, not necessarily a medical problem, but snoring and holding your breath is a medical problem. And if, in fact, you're snoring and holding your breath, I can treat a marital problem and a medical problem at the same time. So that's a good outcome. So snoring, again, is one of the features that we look for when we're identifying a patient at risk for sleep apnea. If you have snoring and you have a BMI over 30 or hypertension, if you have snoring plus daytime sleepiness, then the patient needs a referral for a sleep evaluation. But snoring simply by itself does not mean they have sleep apnea. So we look for it in relationship to with at least one other symptom or symptom class. Other questions?
Work with patients who have a diagnosis of PTSD. You'll sometimes hear about them injuring or harming, hitting the sleep part.
Yeah.
And I was wondering when you were talking about REM sleep behavior disorder, is that the same thing? Is it similar? Is it different?
Not the same thing. It's a very good question, though. because well, phenotypically it seems like there's some overlap there. REM sleep behavior disorders, basically, it's in the class of neurodegenerative disorders. Most of the patients that really have REM sleep behavior disorder have no psychiatric history. The classic descriptions from the first cohort that was reported in Minneapolis were these Minnesota farmers that were 70 years old, and all of a sudden their wife was complaining that they were all swinging around and banging their heads and stuff like that. So these are patients that generally don't have a psychiatric history. The patients with what you're describing are generally younger, and if we look at what's happening in the polysomnogram, they will have arousals out of REM sleep, and they will have an arousal associated with a disturbing dream, and they will have some residual experience of dreaming and start acting that out. But they don't, in fact, have this period of REM sleep associated with loss of normal motor autonomia. So these are generally younger patients, and they've got other kind of psychiatric problems. And one can be confused with the other. I had a patient years ago, actually one of the first REM sleep behavior disorder patients I ever saw was a man who came in and said, I have PTSD. And this is a man, when he was 18 years old, was involved in the body recovery from the Texas City oil explosion, 1945, when the ship blew up in Texas City. It was the largest industrial disaster in the history of the United States. Until 9/11, it was actually the largest loss of life of any one time. And he had been involved in the body recovery. He was 18 years old. He had very disturbing dreams after that. But I was seeing him 40 years after this incident, 50 years after the incident. And I asked his wife, well, what's going on when he's having these episodes? And she says, it's not all about Texas City. He gets up and he's like running down the football field, and he's happy about this or that and the other. We did the study, and he had REM sleep behavior disorder. And we gave him clonazepam. And his wife said, oh, these are miracle pills, doctor. These are just little miracle pills. Because as soon as he started the clonazepam, that was suppressing the loss of water atonia during sleep. So this is a patient that had PTSD as a young man, but he had developed a neurodegenerative disorder as a mature adult. And in fact, that's what he was complaining about when he came to see me. Interesting question. Other questions?
I just wanted to...
Yeah.
There's a situation where you can wake up in the morning and you're paralyzed as if you're still in REM sleep, but you're awake and you can see. What's that called?
It's called sleep paralysis. That's that can be a clinical syndrome or it can be a normal variation. So again, during REM sleep, your body is functionally paralyzed. Now, what happens for you to wake up, all your systems have to come back online at the same time. If you regain consciousness before the hyperpolarization of your motor neurons these neurons are repolarized, you'll experience sleep paralysis. You'll have consciousness, but you still feel paralyzed. And that's what we call sleep paralysis. Now that can be an isolated symptom that really is a benign manifestation. It may not require any treatment at all. If the patients have it recurrently and it bothers them, and a low dose of a tricyclic antidepressant which actually suppresses REM sleep can be a very effective treatment. If it occurs in conjunction with sleepiness, it may be a sign of what we call narcolepsy. And narcolepsy is actually an illness, a neurologic disorder, where features of REM sleep intrude into wakefulness. And patients with narcolepsy will have daytime sleepiness. Oftentimes they'll have sleep paralysis. They may have what we call hypnagogic hallucinations, which are these little bursts of REM sleep that occur during the transition from wakefulness to sleep. These are all features of REM sleep that are somehow intruding into the transition between waking and sleep or sleep and waking. So, good question. Yeah, other questions?
How long will the apnea symptoms improve when the patient lost weight?
So, how long
patient symptoms stop the apnea improve?
If a patient can achieve normal body weight, a large number of them will have a complete remission of their sleep apnea symptoms. So, and this can, of course, be associated with either surgical weight loss or behavioral weight loss. So right now, in my private clinic, I see every patient that's referred for the surgical weight loss program at Wilford Hall Medical Center, actually now SAMC. And every patient that's referred for bariatric surgery actually has to have a a sleep study as part of their preoperative assessment because untreated sleep apnea is a surgical risk factor. About half the patients have sleep apnea, it turns out. If they do return for a follow-up study after they've achieved a normal body weight, I would guess that, over half of them actually no longer have symptomatic sleep apnea, the ones that have been able to capture for a return visit. So we know that weight loss, either behavioral or surgical, can result in a resolution of sleep apnea. But again, as we were talking about earlier, they have patients with normal body weight that have sleep apnea. Okay, thank you very
thank
much.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
You want slides?
Betcha.
Hey,
I can get him a copy of slides.
I'd be happy to pass along to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.